I was going to do something fun, and now I can't. Well, sort of can't. This is what I was going to do. This is 100 Watts in a Wire. Episode 251. Way ahead of those guys. Well, I stole their logo. And the reason that I can't is because Christian got some bad news that he reported in last week's show, which came out, I think, on Friday, yesterday as I record this. This is Saturday afternoon, not quite 4 o'clock. Let's see. Maybe he can explain it. This is the episode that he did with where did I go? Sometimes I hate the internet. Yeah, interviewed Karen Eve Murray, who's the woman who's doing the writing for Newsline now. Where am I supposed to be? Way over here. The heck. So can I listen to a little bit of that? Will he tell us what's going on? I think maybe he will. Put my cursor in the right place.
Support for 100 Watts in a Wire is brought to you by 100wattsinawire.com.
Thought I got past his
HF transceiver will far
thought I got past his ads
for a radio considered entry level. Visit icomamerica.com/amateur.
Help me advertise ICOM.
Welcome to 100 Watts in a Wire. I'm Christian K0STH, and before I get too deep into this show, I want to talk about Katie for just a second. Now, some of you are going, oh, I knew something was happening. What's happened? Is it vacation? Is it? What, did you have a fight? Was there some kind of dirty laundry? Nope, none of that. No drama. Now, we both volunteer our time to meet up very
early. Okay, he's going to kind of take a long time to get around to this. But what he's getting at is that Katie has taken a new job. Just trying to control my computer again here. Katie's got a new job, and if you look at her Facebook page, it says here, former, I hate the internet, former, it is not going to cooperate, former technical support specialist at Ham Radio Deluxe. And it's not saying what she's doing now. So I don't know. And he didn't know. Maybe he did. And he just wasn't going to steal his thunder and say so. And we all like Katie. We all love Katie. And she's been a great asset to the show, but it sounds like she won't be able to be a regular participant on 100 Watts on a Wire. So that's why I feel bad about usurping their name. The reason why I was going to usurp their name is because ain't nobody on that show doing 100 Watts on a Wire anymore. I mean, come on. Katie never did 100. She always ran a kilowatt and had a 500-foot tower and a 40-element beam on top of it. I exaggerate. She and her husband had a big antenna farm, beams, and big amplifier and stuff. So she was never 100 watts in a wire. She could be, if she wanted to run barefoot on 40 meters or something with a dipole. She could be 100 watts in a wire, but she most of the time wasn't. Christian started out as 100 watts on a wire. That's the way he got started. And he's just celebrated his first year anniversary on Ham Radio. So within that first year, he got tired of being beat up as 100 watts on a wire. And so he got an amplifier. I think he's 500 watts. And he put up a hex beam. And it's all been a big part of the show. It's been fun to follow his progress. But in his first year, he's no longer 100 watts in a wire guy anymore. So they're going to have, still trying to control the internet. They're going to have to change the name of the show. It's, it's not 100 watts in a wire anymore. It's 500 watts in a hex beam. I, however, on the other hand, have never operated ham radio. Well, operated, yes, but owned and built myself anything more than 100 watts in a wire. Oh, some of the early radios back in the days when we measured input power versus instead of output power, I had a a Drake TR4. Actually, my brother had a Drake TR4. He won it at a ham fest. I don't think I went to that year either. he won a TR4, his first prize. I think it was the Starved Rock Ham Fest in Illinois. And he was fading out of ham radio, so I pretty much inherited it and used it. That radio was rated at 300 watts input. And so with 50 to 60% efficiency, it was probably 150 to 175 watts output. So that's the most power I've ever run. And dipoles, mostly a couple of verticals. I run beams on 2 meters and 6 meters, but never on HF. So this station back there, I can show you a close up of it. And even make it show frequency instead of the screensaver. That station is barefoot ICOM 756 Pro 3 and up on the roof, 150-foot dipole. And in fact, that radio isn't even 100 watts anymore. You may recall when I had trouble with the radio getting real hot, even when it was turned off, and it turned out to be the driver transistors, which were still drawing a lot of current. One of them had shorted. And my friend Jeff, the guy who can do all the surface mount soldering and stuff, he pulled the drivers out. We stole a pair of drivers from my old 756 original, not even pro, not even amateur, the very first 756 ICOM made. It's been gathering dust on a shelf for a long time. So it got to be useful. It became the donor radio of a pair of drivers. But with those driver transistors in it, it's only putting out about 75, 80, 85 watts, somewhere in there. So that being the case, this is 85 watts in a wire. Well, okay. Ham Radio Now, episode 251. Sorry, Christian. I'm sure you will find a guest host. He hasn't called me. And fill in people, things like that, and get the show back on track. But Katie was fun to listen to. She was good foil. It's supposed to be a partnership, not a primary host and sidekick relationship. So I think that she did good there. I was kind of hoping it, just as he started things up after I did the episode with her and Sean last year on Field Day and Media, that, you know, maybe I could use a good guest host or a good co-host to be on the program. And I was thinking, yeah, I should ask Katie because she's pretty good. And he did. And now he won't say the name of the show. He won't say Ham Radio Now. Once in a while, he says Gary's show. Never says Ham Radio Now. Christian, say it.
Say it. Say it.
Yeah, we did that before. What's next? My own news, I guess. Look at this here. This is the new Ham Radio Now .tv website. And, you know, maybe the big news of it is that it really is hamradionow.tv. It's not arvideonews.com anymore. In fact, if you type in AR, the old real URL, AR video new, okay, it got filled in for me. My fingers were too far along. Arvideonews.com, and push the button, it comes up hamradionow.tv. The old ugly website is gone. And this is a familiar graphic. It's the montage of programs that we've done in the past. There's this big click here to enter. That was kind of an issue when I first put it up. And people are still saying, well, the montage is busy and I don't know where to get into the site. I made it as big and obtrusive as I can. This is a Squarespace site. The reason for doing all of this is that the internet service provider, the guy that's done my email and websites and pretty much everything else I've done on internet except for Gmail, has gone out of business. It's April 23rd, and on April 30 days says September, April 30th, end of the day, April 30th, He pulls the plug. Anything that's on his servers, no longer seeing the internet. Wipes it all out. So I had to find a place to go put stuff up. And, you know, just been, like everybody else, been hearing forever about Squarespace. So I thought I would give it a try. One of the nice things about Squarespace is it is, quote, mobile responsive. It will adapt itself to whatever devices that that you're looking at, that you're looking at it on. I'm going to try to look at it on Nexus 9 tablet here. And let me switch to the microcam, the camera on the microphone. So another thing that I've done here recently is I've upgraded all of the PCs to Windows 10. A little scary, but everything went pretty well. A little glitch here and there. But for the most part, things have gone pretty well. The one that I was most scared to do is this one over here, the Wirecast computer. Oh, I've got another camera I can show. Not that camera, this camera. Here we go. The Wirecast computer. This is the one that does all my live switching and everything. I was a little bit scared of that because it has so many specialized things that it's connected to, all of these cameras and things. And there have been a few issues with it. I'll boot it up and it won't be seeing any of the cameras, and I'll reboot and then it does. And I haven't had time to investigate and find out what the problem is. And the other thing that seems to be happening, not that one, this one, is now I got a lot of lag in the little USB cameras, the microcam. This is the microcam. Well, this picture shows it well enough. It's just a Logitech C910. And the one back there that looks at the radio, that's a C920. They both got lag issues, and I don't know what the problem is yet, so I haven't been able to solve it. But anyway, so I've got to hold things still. Make it a little darker. So this is what the website looks like on this device, and you compare them, the click here to enter thing is in a different spot. And whenever you move things around, oh, I've got to tell it not to be just landscape, be automatic. There we go. It swaps itself around and reconfigures. Do the same thing on a phone. So if I were to do that on a phone, it would be... it would fit the screen as well as they can figure out how to make it fit the screen. So what do we got here? Let's click to enter. And welcome to the new site. This row of things across the top. Oh, my cursor's not showing up. I think I turned that off. Is it? If I switch it here, no. Cursor doesn't show up anywhere. Oh, well. So, do it like this. This row up here is how you get to things. This is just sort of the introduction page. And a little bit of temporary stuff up here about the audio feed. For those of you that like to listen to the program on audio, in fact, you may be doing that right now instead of watching it. Because the long programs are easier to fit into your day around all the other things that you do. If it's just audio, something you can listen to, commuting, working out, cleaning the house, whatever you do. So I appreciate the folks that just listen on audio, and I've tried to keep something that you can download, subscribe to on your podcast applications on the phone. Let's take a look at what have I got on the phone here. So The podcast app that I've been using lately is called Podcast Republic. Yes, I like listening to Rachel. I also like listening to Bill O'Reilly. So it keeps me, there we go. Keeps me balanced, fair and balanced. So Ham Radio Now is here someplace. There we go. The old show and the new version. Still too bright. No one ever accuses me of being too bright. There we go. So Ham Radio Now is on the podcast app. This is a new service that is hosting the audio, because the audio used to sit on the website. They really didn't like that, I don't think, although they never complained to me about it. I don't think I'm the reason that they're going out of business. It was too many files, too many big files on the website. The audio files are 30 to 40, 50 megabytes big, and way too much download, gigabytes of download from the website. So a fella has volunteered to host the audio. He's got plenty of server space and bandwidth. You know, it would be an infinitesimal part of his company's big bandwidth capabilities. So he's volunteered to do that, but we haven't been able to get it set up yet, and I needed to get this stuff someplace. So it went to a service that is built to host podcast stuff. It's called Libsyn, Libsyn. A lot of the podcasts that you listen to, if you listen to podcasts, could be coming from there. So, but when I did that, when I set it up there, the podcast app connection broke. Couldn't point the feed to where it's currently going. So if you've got Ham Radio Now in your podcast app, it was looking at an odd, awkward, long address. And in theory, it'll be able to look at a simple address. And also in theory, you should be able to just search for it, but that can take a while to get going. And I don't think that the search is working yet. Let's see. Search for podcasts, Ham Radio Now. And tell it to search. And yeah, nothing's found yet. So in theory, that will work because it will be going through iTunes. And one of the things that Libsyn does is sort of automatically get you set up on iTunes. And I think I pushed all the right buttons to get that working, but I might not have. We'll look and see. So anyway, there's that RSS thing. And just sort of a general introduction for the folks that may have not have come upon the program again. Episodes is going to be an issue. The old Ham Radio Now site had every episode on it with its own separate page that's over 250 little pages. And when you're making them one at a time, one a week or so, that's not too hard. Although it is one of the things that ended up taking a lot of my time after I recorded the episode, got it edited, titles and stuff on it. I still spent another 5 or 6 hours just messing around with websites and feeds and announcements and stuff. And this will help automate some of that stuff. So I will probably have a couple of current episodes, maybe 4 or 5 current episodes, and then we'll just send you off to YouTube. I'll try to build maybe an index page, simple web page that lists the shows and gives you links to the YouTube feeds. They're all on YouTube anyway. That's really where they live. And if I can do that without spending way too much time, I'll try to do something like that. Let's see what else here. So the most recent 5 or 6 will still show up, and you know, still just play them from YouTube like that. Here's the page that gives you the specific information about being able to listen and subscribe to the audio. Arvin's got to have his page, which reminds me, if you're watching this program, Arvin's sitting back there covering you up. Sorry, Arvin. So, yeah, hamradionow.tv. Stop by and see Arvin. And I'm going to apologize, first of all, for not having done a show in several weeks, partly from working on all this website stuff. It kind of used up what free time I have, partly because, as I've said more than once, I'm not very efficient. So in the course of a day, unless I've got a client who's going to use me all day, I don't get up early enough. I spend some time working out, get lunch, feed cats. The cat operation here is a major undertaking now. And go to lunch and then come back and get a couple of productive hours in. And then it's time to feed cats again. And Cindy's back. And we have dinner and watch TV, goof off. I should work harder. I want to be an entrepreneur, but I don't. Again, unless something really big is happening and I really need to put in the time. So between working on the website and taking care of business, the show has suffered. Hadn't had a new one in a while. There's been a lot of things that I wanted to do. I'll talk about some of them in a minute. And, oh, yeah, the other thing is that for the next couple of weeks, there's going to be no more show because Cindy and I are going out of town. It's our spring vacation time. When you see me duck below the microphone, you know it is time for a co-host. Maui Mouse, the co-host of the show. There she is. That was, still not, I know where my cameras are. There's Maui Mouse, the co-host of the show. And if you you can see that she's missing some fur here, that's been another thing that's been getting a lot of our time. She's not doing too well. She's 12 years old. We got her as a rescue. Someone found her in the street. So she was a kitten about that time, not, you know, kind of an adolescent kitten. In 2004 when we adopted her. So best we can tell, she's 12, maybe 13 years old. That's not ancient in cat years. Cats can live 15, 20 years, but she's not doing real well. She has a form of lymphoma. She's not eating right and is feeling pretty puny. So I don't know how much longer the mouse is going to be with us. We hope for a while. I mean, we're doing what needs to be done. She's at ultrasounds and x-rays and getting medication and, you know, blood tests and stuff, but, you know, it's getting a little dicey on the mouse. So what I was saying is that Cindy and I are going to go out of town for a couple of weeks. Normally I don't tell the world before we're going out of town. You know, it's just not a good idea. Don't go on Facebook and say, Hey everybody, we're leaving for a couple of weeks. Our house is going to be empty, our apartment or whatever. Come steal my ham radio equipment and my ancient plasma TV. You don't want to, if you're going to come steal that, bring a couple of helpers and a truck because it is heavy. These new TVs, well, it's big. It's 58 inches and 270 pounds. So bring some friends. But the reason why I don't feel uncomfortable telling you that is there's actually going to be a family living here because these cats need all this attention. So Cindy had some friends who were moving in between houses and jobs and things, and they have volunteered to just stay here for the time we're out of town. Works for them, works for us. So the place is fully occupied, but they can't make shows. So till we're back, then we'll have a couple of weeks when we get back before Dayton, and I should be able to squeeze out a few shows that have been in the can. And then I'm planning on going to Dayton. You know what happened with Orlando? I was all set to go to Orlando. I had booths. I don't have a booth in Dayton this year. I thought about it. I looked at the booth layout they had at the time. I looked very early part of this year. They had a few last-minute booths still left. They were on, as far as I could tell, they were on some of the ground that is uneven. If you're familiar with Dayton, you know, in Audio Alley, there's some booths that are on a slope. They're on a ramp. And there's a couple of those ramps, and they put booths on them, but you're sitting in your booth all day like that. It's not so great. So those are the ones that I think they had available. And I decided that I didn't want to spend the money for it. That the booth makes a great place to even just store stuff, so I'm not carrying it in and out of the car all the time. But I would have wanted to set up the studio in a booth. So this time I'm planning on rounding up four or five forums to watch, and then spending the other time walking around, doing interviews and looking the usual stuff, looking for interviews for manufacturers or people who make products or do things that don't get a lot of the public eye, that don't get a lot of publicity. If somebody's doing something in ham radio, they do it at Dayton, or they bring it to Dayton or whatever. So be looking for those folks. There's always a bunch of them. We've done that before. I might go by the Icon booth and have Ray talk to me about the 7300, but everybody's done that. So I don't know. We'll see. Still recording? Yep, still recording. Windows 10, you know, kind of want to make sure things are still working. So that's my plan. I feel bad for the folks that contribute on a regular basis, because you're on Patreon or on, well, come to think of it, over here on the contribute page, a new thing for credit card. It's not PayPal. I'll probably get PayPal back. And the PayPal, for those of you that have a subscription going on PayPal, that I'm not turning that off. It's still going to keep on going. But at least from the website anyway, you're not going to find a link to PayPal, at least not right now. And it's mostly because I just don't understand how to build this website very well. Squarespace is a little different. Templates and not a lot of customization unless you're really good and deep into customization, and I'm not. So you're not going to see the PayPal thing. This button is the same thing. It's just a different service. It's a service that is set up through and allied with Squarespace. So same thing, credit card. But I didn't set up a subscription thing through that. If you're going to do a subscription, if you want to help out monthly, and I think that's great, then Patreon is still the way to do it. How's our Patreon doing? What do we got here? 46 people, $316 bucks a month. So the first, around the 5th or 6th, that's when the that money is collected from your credit cards as part of Patreon and then sent on to me. And appreciate that. There's still a couple of hundred that are coming in from subscriptions in PayPal. And then people have been making individual contributions to PayPal up until a couple days ago when I turned that stuff off. The other thing here is that the other website had still the possibility of buying the DVDs. And I couldn't leave that there, just no way to do that. And rebuilding it's going to be a lot of trouble. So I don't know if I'm ever going to attempt to sell DVDs again. I didn't sell very many. I still got a handful sitting over there on a shelf that would probably be nice to sell off, and I'd make a few hundred bucks. Most of the DVDs that people have been ordering are the ones that I ran out of a long time ago and still have to make a custom one. So if somebody buys a DVD for 20 or 25 bucks, I got to spend an hour and make a custom copy. I'm not going to go make 100 copies. Not do anything at the scale that would keep the cost down and the time down. So not really that interested. And almost every program, including all the old Tapper programs, almost every program that I've ever done, even from the old DVDs, is now online. And anything that's not will be well before the end of this year, I think. I'll try. Anyway, so what else over here? So that's the deal on that. If you know of a DVD and you want one, I put a form here where you can send it to me and I'll figure out a price and have you pay for it. So we'll see. Patreon, what is next? So on to the things that I really wanted to do, and won't be able to do in the show because just couldn't get things lined up between talking to potential guests and sending email back and forth and people disappearing. I'll say, well, let's get a schedule, and no email comes back, and I should call them on the phone, but didn't really have time, or maybe the energy or the enthusiasm or whatever. Anyway, here's something I wanted to do. And you know, it occurs to me, we can take a listen to this. NVIS Antenna Day in Ohio is, in fact, it is today. And I swapped some email with Stan. Stan Broadway, N8BHL, is the Section Emergency Coordinator for Ohio. And he's the one that announced this Antenna Day on the league's website. And here's their website all about it. So there's Stan. And it started a little while ago. Was that? He had a countdown clock. I'm seeing minus 6 hours, 22 minutes. It might have been going all day. It doesn't say whether this is UTC or Central or Eastern or whatever. I did listen around. There's the frequencies that they're talking about. And I did listen around a little bit, but let me punch up this radio here. .7250 is one of the frequencies that he had talked about. Like they were going to set frequencies up every 10 kilohertz. So, I don't know, maybe we're hearing somebody there. Oh. Yeah, I'm not really hearing anybody. Yeah, barely. I've got a fairly high noise level on 40. And still something just kind of barely there in the background. They probably wouldn't be that much in the background if I solved my noise problem. So it occurs to me, hello from behind the mic, other camera, there we go. It occurs to me I didn't really explain NVIS yet, so let's do that. Near vertical incident skywave. I would have talked to Stan and had him explain all this stuff to you. I know a little bit about it, especially the lower frequencies. The idea is you want to use 40 meters, 75 meters, 60 meters for that fairly local communication, especially daytime, but even at night in emergencies, beyond repeater range, or maybe the repeaters have gone down if you've got a link system or something. 100 to 300 miles. North Carolina is about 350 miles wide, I think. It's a pretty wide state. Most states, a little less territory to cover than that, so just a couple of hundred miles. And it would be nice to concentrate as much signal as you can into that small distance. And normally in ham radio, the idea is talk as far as you can, low angle of radiation, you know, take it off toward the horizon, go out there and work the DX. But in this case, especially for emergency services and stuff, you want to cover your state. And the bands that do that best are 40, 60, and 80 meters, depending on the time of day. And what you want to do to operate like that is to send your signal up almost straight up and have it bounce as close to straight down as you can. Straight up doesn't work all that well, but at a small angle on that spectrum, and the closer to the middle of the day it is, the closer to 80 meters, things do that. But even 60 and 40 do a pretty good job of that near vertical incidence angle of reflection. So send your signal almost straight up and comes down not that far away, 50, 100, 150, 200 miles. Any antenna does that. But if you can concentrate your signal up and avoid those low lobes, as much of the signal as possible heading toward the horizon, then you get a little stronger signal from what's going up and down. And at night, when signals are rolling in from greater distances, you can attenuate them some. The question is, how well does that work? And what do the antennas look like? How well does that work? And if I could be talking to Stan, I'd be asking those questions and hopefully getting their answers. But today in Ohio, they are doing a test. They've got what they call anchor stations. And their goal is to have everybody go out there and have a couple of different kinds of NVIS antennas and hook up one and make contact with the anchor stations and get signal reports and then switch the antenna, try a different kind of antenna and get signal reports. One of the things I would ask him is, well, propagation changes minute by minute, significantly hour by hour. So you kind of got to do this fast. So how will all that work? So maybe we'll get a chance to talk to him after this test. They've done this before. It's not purely scientific. It's an amateur test. Ham's doing a ham test. But it probably yields them some useful information. And it gets people building these antennas. The basic concept is you'd start with a wire and usually fairly low to the ground. And instead of making a beam with horizontal parallel elements, you make it a beam with a reflector across the bottom, below the antenna, and reflecting more signal going up. You know, it's not 30 dB of gain. It's not 10 dB of gain. A few dB gets the signal a little stronger. Anyway, that would have been something interesting to talk about. What else? The reason I'm bringing this up is, first of all, it is a program that I would want to do, both this one and this one, the band planning. And the reason I'm bringing them up, and someday we'll be able to talk to them, but the league announced that these were things that they were looking at this point. And I sent email to one of their vice presidents, Brian, N5ZGT. N5ZGT is an interesting call sign. It was my original mentor in ham radio when I was a teenager, and this fellow was a teenager, was Bob, K9ZGT. Don't run into very many ZGTs. He's not ZGT anymore. He's K8IE. Excuse me. But so Brian's call is always caught my attention. I never talked to him, never met him in person. I'll pretend I made an edit and just go back to this. It's still froggy. So I've never met Brian or talked to him, but I did swap email with him and said, well, I'd like to talk to these things. And he did what folks at the league and other places do all the time when I ask them about doing shows. And I want to tell you about it so you understand some of the things that happen. He said, well, let's talk about it when it is settled, when it's done. We've got things all figured out. And my response to that is always, it is news that you're looking into it. It was news enough to put it on the ARL website. Something is causing the league to want to look into these things. And yes, the last I's have not been crossed and T's dotted. And the thing is still going to go on, but there is a reason why. And so CNN and Fox News and ABC, NBC, CBS, they don't wait until everything is all done before they do their story. They do the story when things come up. And then maybe as they have, there's something in progress, they do a story of things in progress. And then when things have concluded and they can actually report on the results, they'll do a story like that. For example, the biggest example right now is that they are not waiting for the presidential conventions to report on the race. They're reporting all the time. They don't wait on any individual primary to for all the voting to take place to tell you about what's going on with that primary. They report the heck out of it before. And actually, it's kind of anticlimactic. Once all the voting is done, they say, and this guy won. That woman won. Next. Go racing off to the next thing. The results are a little anticlimactic. It wouldn't work quite that way here. But when I see an interesting topic come up and it hasn't been resolved yet, there are some reasons why it's come up. Well, let's talk about that. It's difficult to get people in that mindset. I don't even know why they announced that they're looking into OOs or ban plans if they don't want to talk about it until it's all done. I think they were asking for some member input on the ban plans anyway. So one of the troubles to getting that done. And the other problem is that I get a little frustrated and my personality gets a little acerbic and it's like, I don't want to wait. Let's do it now. And then they don't even answer the email. So that's where I am with Brian. And if Brian sees this, maybe the last time he ever communicates with me, or he may say, I see what Gary's talking about. We'll see. Next. What was this one? Another couple of ARL things. Oh, okay. Well, I'll make them happier with me. The league has not done a lot of media besides QST. They do a little bit of YouTube stuff. They shoot some simple overviews in some of their reviews of equipment, and once in a while do a special program. But they haven't done any regular occurring media until now. And it's this thing, The Doctor Is In podcast. And it's QST editor Steve Ford and the doctor, Joel Hallis, W1ZR. And they get together and it's an audio podcast. And I've listened to the first one on antennas and they're great. They're a lot of fun to listen to. They keep it down to, I don't know, a half hour or so. And you can subscribe as a podcast, and this will make the technical people happy because it's all technical stuff. Let's see, can I even play it from here? Okay, they're using one of the other podcast hosts. They're using Blueberry, so I'm on Libsyn. They're on Blueberry. Let's see if we can listen for a moment, anyway. Oh, yeah. So they've got two out apparently now. This is the one that I listen to. Let's listen to that for a second.
From the headquarters of the American Radio Relay League in Newington, Connecticut, this is ARRL, The Doctor Is In, a biweekly podcast addressing common and...
Okay. 10 times as much noise power on single sideband as there will on CW if the noise is uniform across the spectrum, which it typically is for most kinds of noise. So that gives you a 10 dB advantage. That means all other things being equal, 10 watts of CW will have the same signal noise ratio as 100 watts of single sideband. So,
wow.
So that's one, but that's just the first part.
Wait, more. There's more. Yeah.
There's more.
The next thing we have is the fact
that... Okay, so what I'm getting from this right now is that, attention Bob Heil, send these guys some PR40s. Did this one sound better? I think this one might have sounded better. I don't know. Oh, there's the go button.
And the only problem with that is if you have room, height, not terribly critical because it's a whole different animal from setting up antennas, let's say, for most of us. And
I don't know if...
Since they don't have to be buried.
What I'm hearing...
Just roll out some wire and hook it up.
Here...
Well, and this could be any old wire, whatever you happen to pick up at a flea market or whatever.
I don't remember it sounding a little hollow and, you know, not all that high fidelity when I listened to it on earbuds. But in any case, Bob, send them some PR40s. Well, the league's got a bunch on their stations. Go steal some of the PR40s. I guess they need a little studio. That would be nice. They should have had an audio studio, even a television studio, long time ago. But I'm glad to see they're at least starting this. And, you know, it's technical. It'll keep the technical guys pretty happy. So there is that. And just stuck this one up because I think this is cool. I have only worked, maybe by May 14th, I'll be back and can get on a show with some guys before this happens. I think that would be nice. I operated one of these things, and it's basically you talk to a military station, and you know, it's a crossband test. They're transmitting on Mars frequencies. Once in a while, Mars gives you the indication that they try to keep their frequencies a secret. And then they publish them all for this, or at least they publish a lot of them for this. They're transmitting on Mars frequencies, but they're listening in the ham band. So you transmit to them in the ham band and you call them, which is weird. You call them with their military call sign or identification, and they respond to you with your ham radio call sign. It's all legal, of course. You know, the FCC has approved it all. And I think I worked two or three stations across the country in different bands. It wasn't a wham-bam contact. They took some time to talk to me. And I don't remember in detail right now, but I asked the guy to describe the station that he was operating. I think they were running Harris equipment and a fair amount of power and big antennas and stuff like that. So it was pretty cool. He was quite proud of it. He was a ham, and but quite proud of the military communications capability that they have on HF that they could talk to us with using our modes, but probably most of the time they use some form of data and digital modes. So what is it? The May 14th. If you got HF, I would recommend looking this up, giving it a try, and have some fun with that. One last thing before we go. The folks in Missouri have had some success with their state version of the Amateur Radio Parity Act. It has actually passed the House, and I've got a little audio. It's a little audio and video, but the video doesn't really show very much. The cameras don't usually sit there focused on the folks on the dais, on the podium. The folks leading the show, they just kind of have a general broad picture of the room where the House meets or the committees meet. And, you know, just you see people at their desks and stuff, but nothing is specific to what's going on. So I'll show that picture and listen to a little bit of what those folks are saying about us. I'll kind of edit this together and you'll hear a few different comments, pro and con, and you can make up your own mind what you think about these things, but my impression that I'll lead you into it with is that a lot of it is headpats, and we don't really understand this ham radio thing very well. And you know, they just kind of go to ground with the talking points that they've been working with without really discussing and debating things. You know, people just make their point. Maybe someone's persuaded, maybe not. They had a vote. It didn't look close. It was like 85 to 66 or something. It didn't look close, but it was explained to me that that threshold to pass was like 82. So just barely got it through. But in any case, it has passed the Missouri House. And there is a corresponding Senate bill. And they've had a couple of committee meetings and a hearing, and some hams testified at the hearing, and I cannot find any archive audio or video of that Senate hearing. Best I can tell, they don't keep a record like that. They haven't taken a vote. It's coming up soon. So Larry Scantlin is trying to chase people into communicating with their senators, and they're not sure that it's going to make it all the way through the Senate. But if it does, they got themselves a bill. They got themselves a law. Well, I guess they get the governor to sign it. And then they got themselves a parity act in Missouri before anything happens in the whole rest of the country. Speaking of which, all quiet on that front. Waiting for the Energy and Commerce Committee to take it up. And kind of thought something might have happened by now, but there's been no word. Still background negotiating or probably they're doing other stuff. You know, Congress is busy with other stuff. We're not the most important thing they're doing, but maybe somewhere in the background, some aide in the league and the community institute, community associations institute are working on things. And if I could do all the shows I wanted to do, I'd do one with those guys, the CAI guys, get them to talk to me. Might happen sometime. We'll see. But not for the next couple of weeks, because Cindy and I will be gone. Let's listen to a little bit of what those guys are saying in Missouri.
General St. Charles, for what purpose do you rise?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move for the third reading of House Bill 1951 as amended.
General St. Charles has moved the third reading and passage of House Bill 1951. General St. Charles.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The mayor of New Orleans and the governor of Louisiana, after Hurricane Katrina, thank the ham radio operators because they basically said in many, many articles that without these individuals that had the ham radios, this disaster could have been a lot worse. In 1983, the federal government passed a law that basically said that no state, no county, no city can pass any laws that would restrict ham radios. And there was a basis for that dealing with national security and dealing with disasters. Senate Bill, Federal Senate Bill 1685 and House of Representatives 1301 with bipartisan support is going through Congress right now in support of ham radios. This bill basically mirrors those bills. What is happening is HOAs are now putting on restrictions in their covenants against ham radio towers. This bill basically says that HOAs need to make reasonable accommodations for these ham radio towers. And when people talk about ham radio towers, they think Eiffel Towers. But there is a large, wide variety of different types of towers out there that could be simple as a small thing about the size of the microphone that I'm using today, or you can have much bigger towers. If you've ever been to a ham radio rodeo, you can see a wide variety of towers that these ham radios use. We heard a lot of argument about dealing with HOAs and them being a private contract between the HOA and the homeowners. And most of the time I would agree with these people. However, the problem is government is already involved. In many, many court cases that I looked at, the HOAs were on the losing end of these court battles based upon the laws that were passed in 1983. The one case that I found that the HOA won dealt with camouflaging the tower. And what we're asking for is a reasonable accommodation. It takes all these court cases out of the courts. And reasonable could be a wide variety of things. You heard people talk about that it could be disguised in a flagpole. For these reasons, Mr. Speaker, I asked the body to pass and third reading finally pass House Bill 1951 as amended. And if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Further discussion. Gentleman from Jasper, for what purpose do you rise?
To speak against the bill, Mr. Speaker.
Proceed, gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this bill is not about ham radios being a bad thing. Or, you know, the people, the HSAs this is talking about are not about ham radios being a bad thing. The HSAs, the restrictive covenants, deal with towers. I represent Joplin. I've represented Joplin for 5 years, including when we had a tornado. Ham radios were very important in our tornado and our disaster recovery. But these were primarily temporary portable antennas. This is not a scenario where people worked out of their houses with tall antennas already there. What this bill says is that any covenant, a restriction or condition contained in a contract, any legal document is void this is not saying from here on out you can't create a restrictive covenant, a homeowners association agreement that bans towers. This goes back and changes every restrictive covenant that has ever been written in the state that says no towers. This is what you, we rely on the law. We rely on the supremacy of contracts between individuals. When you buy a property that has restrictive covenants, covenants that has agreements that says no towers, then you buy that relying on that. It affects your property values. It affects your decision to buy this property. When these people who have ham radios, which, by the way, I indicated in last discussion, I'm learning. I've got the book. I'm trying to get my own ham radio license. That's a different subject. I'm not saying ham radios are bad. HSAs aren't saying ham radios are bad. They're not against ham radios. They're specifically saying no towers. The bill sponsor said towers can be little things you can't see. They can be camouflaged, or they can be tall towers. They can be not the Eiffel Tower, but they can be big towers. Depends on what you're doing with your radio, your range, things like that as to why you're going to have different kinds of towers. But the big point is this is violating contract made by two private parties. The state is coming in and saying what you have agreed to maybe 30, 40 years ago is no longer valid. It is void. This is improper. You know, we could next come in and say, well, gee, mobile homes are really great things. We're going to invalidate any contract, any covenant that says, no, you have to have 2,000 square feet and bricks in the front of your house. No, we could just come back and under the same principle and say, no, we need to have lots more housing, so we'll go in and we'll allow you to have mobile homes, or we'll allow you to have three mobile homes on a lot. That's a little outrageous, but it's the same thing. You're changing and violating private contract that has already been in place. If this bill said from here on out you can't do it, I have a lot less problem with this bill. But this changes agreements that people relied on and bought property on. So I would strongly encourage the body to say we are not going to go back and change contracts that have been private contracts that have been in place for decades, potentially. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Further discussion. Leave St. Louis County, for what purpose you rise?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, to speak on the bill.
Proceed, lady.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I generally don't like the slippery slope arguments, and it's not very often that I agree with the gentleman from Jasper, but I think he is completely right on this front. Not only does it invalidate existing contracts, but more importantly, there already is a remedy. If you don't like the covenants in the Homeowners Association, you can get elected to the Homeowners Association. You can lobby those folks to try and change the laws, and you can change the agreements. And more importantly, you can change those agreements that have reasonable limitations. The way that the bill is written right now, it says reasonable limitations for the purpose that it seeks. I don't know what that's supposed to even mean, frankly. And the bottom line is that if a ham radio operator wants to put up the Eiffel Tower of towers, despite existing restrictions, this bill lets them do it. And that's for folks that have already bought their houses based upon the covenants and the restrictions. That's just not fair. And I think that the gentleman from Jasper makes some very good points. If the bill was going forward, it would be more palatable. Even if the bill had more clear size restrictions, it might be more palatable. But as it stands right now, I cannot support it. And it's not about how good ham radios are. It's not about the service that they perform. It's about the state of Missouri and the General Assembly trying to overcome the will of a contract that had already been entered into sometimes many years ago. For that reason, I cannot support it. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Further discussion. Gentleman Clay, for what purpose do you rise?
To speak on the bill, Mr. Speaker.
Proceed, gentlemen.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, this bill does not nullify any contracts that have been made. It just simply says that the Homeowners Association should try to make a reasonable accommodation. Now, I have been a treasurer for 3 years on a Homeowners Association, been to a lot of homeowners meetings, and what the complaint here is that this somehow forces them to make these changes, but it doesn't. They're still going to have to work with their Homeowners Association board. They're still going to need to have the Homeowners Association make some decisions and choices and come to a reasonable accommodation so that, I mean, if they don't want Paris Eiffel Towers, there won't be any Eiffel Towers. If they're going to allow little short antennas, they'll allow little short antennas. It just allows flexibility, so homeowners associations will be encouraged to allow these radio amateurs to use their equipment in a way that'll be a benefit to the community, to that homeowners association, and I urge the body to support this bill. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Further discussion? Gentleman from St. Louis City, for what purpose do you rise?
I'm having one of those moments where my colleague from St. Louis City just said one thing, and then the gentleman from Jackson just said another thing, and they were exactly the opposite. Who's right? I don't get it.
Well, I have to admit I went out and got a cup of coffee right after I got done talking. But
the gentleman that just spoke said that this isn't retroactive. It's not going to change anything that the Homeowners Association did before. It's just going forward. Now you got to sit down with the Homeowners Association and negotiate out what will work.
It is totally retroactive. It says they are not. It says they are void. When you read the language of the statute, it says agreements like this are void. And then it talks about making reasonable accommodations, but it says that any restriction that is not reasonable is void. So it's going back. It is retroactive. It is not from going from here forward.
Let me rephrase that just a little bit and tell me if I'm off the mark. So is another way to characterize this bill the following. You will have these ham radio towers. Figure it out. But you will have these ham radio towers.
That is, I think, a rough way of phrasing it, yes.
Okay.
It's saying you've got to make a reasonable accommodation. Right now, these things, if they say no towers, you're voiding that no towers. And everybody, the other 10 or 100 people that bought their property in that relied on the no towers. I have not seen an agreement, an HSA, that doesn't have some method for modifying where you can go through and buy, you know, half, two-thirds, landowners, you can modify your covenants. You can do things like that. I've seen probably 10 of them in my life. I've written a couple. They've always had some method of changing it, but this just voids what's there. It says they're void, and to get this reasonable accommodation, you know, what's out there is gone, and so somehow you've got to reasonably accommodate that there is no option.
Okay, thank you.
Further discussion? Gentleman St. Charles, for what purpose do you rise?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, to speak in support of the bill.
Proceed, gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We've heard a lot of talk on this floor about the government getting involved in private contracts and how we should not do that. Well, the whole point of this bill, the whole reason for this bill, is because of the government getting involved. You know, this is something that the federal government did put upon us. To give you a quick crash course for this body, give you more information about homeowners associations than you probably want to know. A few years back, the federal government passed Clean Water Act. What part of the Clean Water Act said was these developments, these subdivisions that come together, have to have what's called a retention pond for runoff excess water. That retention pond, therefore, takes up a lot in these subdivisions. So the developer's way to deal with this issue was then to form what's called a homeowners association. That's a big reason why they came to prominence lately. With that, you know, without for the federal government getting involved, then we wouldn't have to deal with this issue. So, you know, for then to turn around and go even further and say that the government should get involved, I think something needs to be taken into consideration that there hasn't been a whole lot of talk about on this floor, and that this is a public safety issue. You know, for example, when this tornado came ripping through the Joplin area, one of the last remaining lines of communications that was out there was the ham radio operators. You know, we heard testimony in committee, person after person come in and say that this is a public safety issue. So to sit there and say that the government shouldn't get involved in a public safety issue, I think is a red herring. You know, I think, you know, when we get involved, you know, something that people want to say government doesn't get involved in private contracts. Yes, it does. Every single day, the government gets involved with private contracts that are against public policy. For example, if I contract with somebody else and say, you need to go kill person ABC over there, that contract is null and void. That is a private contract that cannot be enforced. The government gets involved and says that is against public policy, that is against public safety. And as I said before, this is something that there has been numerous testimony that this is a public safety issue. This is a common sense, small step forward. If anything, this bill doesn't go far enough. So, again, this is a common sense legislation that I would urge the body to support. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Further discussion, Gentleman St. Charles, for what purpose do you rise?
to inquire of the bill sponsor.
Does the gentleman St. Charles yield?
I do.
Proceed, gentlemen.
Good afternoon, or evening.
Good evening.
Real quickly, just wanted to touch base with you on just kind of the whole process of getting things changed within a homeowners association. In your experience, how easy is it for you to get something changed, a bylaw or a rule changed within a homeowners association?
Well, in my area, it's one of the fastest growing areas in the state. And in order to get elected to an HOA, you have to have such a certain amount of percentage of your subdivision has to be bought out by the residents. And some of those are stacked against the residents. Like, you don't even get your second person out of a three-person board until 95% of your subdivision is bought out. So to say that, oh, you just, here's a simple way to do it, just get elected to the HOA and then you can make changes there is false. Because, you know, there are several developers in my areas that they'll keep like six lots open where they won't sell them so they can keep two people out of a three-person board.
So what you're saying is it's not an easy task to get elected to the board, and it's also not an easy task to get changes made to bylaws, especially ones that deal with this particular topic.
Correct.
And then you're in subdivisions that can be, or HOAs that can have 500, 600,000 people in the group, and that's quite a bit of people to try to educate on the importance of, you know, ham radios.
That is correct. And, you know, with each one of these concordance or indentures, you know, you get one person at 50 or 60 or 75%, depending on which ones they are. The second person at 85, 90, 95% of it sold out. And then you get your third person. But to get the second one to have majority of the HOA from the developer and the banker, you know, it's tough to get 95%, especially when they have a developer that is only keeping like six lots unsold in order to keep control of the board.
So do most of the homeowners associations right now in Missouri have very restrictive covenants with regards to antennas or anything along that lines? I mean, they're very restrictive as far as what's allowed.
Yeah, there are some that are very restrictive. You know, and these HOAs, have had other indentures that have been overturned. You know, if you look at some homeowners associations, they'll say no signs whatsoever. And the Supreme Court overruled a Ledoux versus Gillian with political signs and temporary signs in yard saying that it's free speech. And so there's another example how government has gotten involved in HOAs and said that you can't take away someone's freedom based upon just having these contracts.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker.
Further discussion. Gentleman from Phelps, for what purpose do you rise?
Speak briefly in favor of the bill.
Proceed, gentlemen.
Mr. Speaker, we live in a dangerous world, and whether through natural disaster or attacks on our electrical grid, our communication system as we know it could be severely impaired. And I intend to vote for this bill to protect my constituents and their ability to communicate with family and get information from authorities when the chips are down. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Further discussion, Lady from Cape Girardeau, for what purpose do you rise?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, to give a perspective on the bill.
Does that mean you'd like to speak on the bill, lady?
Yes, it does.
Proceed.
Mr. Speaker. Thank you very much. About a month ago, we removed the ham radio transmitter out of my father's basement. I remember seeing that radio transmitter for more years than I would like to indicate on the floor, which would also indicate perhaps how old I am. We've been in the wireless communications business since before 1959. And offering a little bit of perspective about this particular industry, number one, the radio communications industry has so rapidly changed over the years that much of the communication cannot even occur between cities unless there is a new digital type of interoperability format that radio communication systems are using in the different municipalities. Ham radio has always been an amateur hobby for many, allowing individuals to speak in different countries across the globe. It continues to be a hobby, and due to the low frequencies of amateur radio, ham radio, the size of the antennas and the size of the equipment are considerably larger than typical FM radio. Much of the technology has reduced the size of not only the units, but the size of the antennas that you see on police cars, and therefore leading to the cellular communication. The merits of the bill are not necessarily public safety. It is a hobby. They can be an asset to public safety in an emergency disaster. The FM two-way radio digital network will be the communication vehicle of choice. Also think about, this is really about homeowners associations. Cities regulate the size of towers. They do in Cape Girardeau and they do in other municipalities. Think about what you might be doing with this particular bill is bigger government removing the ability for homeowners to make decisions about their neighborhood. It's not really about public safety. It's about the rights of property owners in our respective communities. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Seeing no further discussion, Gentleman St. Charles, you are recognized. Close.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I close.
Gentleman St. Charles has renewed his motion for the third reading and passage of House Bill 1951. All those in favor will vote yes. All those opposed will vote no. Mr. Clerk, please ring the bell and open the board. Mr. Clerk, close the board and tally the vote. By your vote of 86 yes and 66 no, you have third read and passed House Bill 1951.
Okay, got to wrap this puppy up. And pack all day tomorrow, and we're on a plane on Monday. So thank you for watching this episode. It's going to be a while before I get another one, so I really was desperate to make something here. I'm sorry it's not all it could have been, but it's something. Get to hear my voice a little bit anyway. And look at the new website. Arvin's still sitting back there, covered up. Say something, Arvin. You can't see the camera. Tell me that I've put the microphone in the wrong place. I feel bad, because if you're not going to get a show, why should you send money? But it's still what keeps us going, so think about it. And for those of you that are contributing on a regular basis, you want to pause, you can. If you want to just keep going, if you can afford it, we'll be back, and we'll be at Dayton and see a lot of you there. So we'll do that. Christian, sorry about Katie. Katie, whatever you're doing next, hope it's going to be great. Don't know if it's going to be in the ham radio realm or not. But I imagine we'll see you at Dayton, and maybe it gets you to show up on Ham Radio Now once in a while. We do need to, Katie and Sean, we need to go over getting publicity for Field Day again. There's been a lot of media out there. I'd like to get their impressions on, so maybe I can gather them back up too, just after Dayton, or maybe even before. We'll see. That is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73. Over and out.